Shekinah Grace 24/7, a church community that trains and equips people to live a supernatural life filled through the Holy Spirit that loves God and one another. We want to advance the kingdom of God locally and globally. We love God and we love the family. You are welcome.
So we just thank you that you guys are here with us. I know some people couldn't make it. I think there was a lady that just sent me a message that she was on her way. So hopefully she does get here. But without further ado, we're just going to go and continue going with the message. I know that we've been speaking a lot about relationship with God. We've been talking a lot about having intimacy with God. We've been talking about having that divine connection with God, not just as a religious way, but a real connection. Not just coming to church just to sing a few songs and saying hello to a few people, but really having a devout life with God. Now, I don't want you guys to raise your hand, but just examine yourself. From the time that we started doing this, how many times or how much time have you felt that you're seeking God? That's a question for yourself. Don't answer it right now, but with the message that we've been talking about and preaching and my wife and I, we've been teaching about it, is this actually affecting you spiritually? Are you really devoting yourself more to God? Is this message really getting into your heart, or are we just saying things, or we're just coming here just to have a good time but not really changing our lives? This is a question that I want you guys to answer, not just today for yourself, but I want you guys to continue thinking about this throughout the weeks, because it's important that we don't just come here and hear me or hear other pastors or preachers to preach here, but when you come here, you literally learn something. Learn something not just about myself or learn something about others here, but we're learning about each other. But the most important thing is that we can learn more about God. Amen?
Amen.
So that's very important. As long as you understand that, and we as a body of Christ know what we're thinking, what we're doing, then we are going to go into that divine connection, into that dimension of the Spirit of God. So we've been talking about intimacy, relationship. We've been talking about the gifts, the fruit of the Spirit. We understand what are the fruit of the Spirit. Some of you guys still probably don't understand, but some of you guys probably already know. So just in case, to refresh your mind, if you guys have a pen and paper, I want you guys to write this down. This is very important that you guys understand what are the fruit of the Spirit. Some of us don't know, and it's good that we understand what are the fruit of the Spirit. So if you guys have a pen and paper, if you guys have something to write down, or even if you have it in your phones, if you want to put it in your iPad, whatever it is, I want you guys to write this down. Fruit of the Spirit is joy, peace, patient, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I'll repeat this again, just in case some of you guys didn't hear me or I was going too fast. Joy, peace, patient, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. These are the 9 fruit of the Spirit. When we are connected by God, with God in His Spirit, these are the fruits that we're going to bear. These are the attitudes. This is the characteristics of who God is. If the Spirit of God abides in us, this is how we're going to, our attitude is going to be. We're going to be joyful. We're going to be peaceful. We're going to be kind. We're going to be good, right? We're going to be faithfulness. We're going to be self-control. So these are the characteristics that we will be if we are connected, right? So we were talking about the other week. So today, I want to talk about the gifts of the Spirit. I'm not talking about the fruit of the Spirit. I'm talking about the gifts of the Spirit. to understand the gift of the Spirit, we need to understand that these are supernatural gifts that God comes and gives it to you. You're not born with it. Some of us are born with talent. Some of us are born with abilities. But these are spiritual gifts that are developed by the Spirit of God, not developed human-wise. Like, I was good at music because I'm not just because I practice every day, but because it was a gift that God has given me. Yes, I developed it and getting it better and better while I was growing and while I was learning and I was practicing. But it's not a spiritual gift until I mix my talent and the spiritual ways together. We mix it together and it becomes something more powerful. The gift that God gave me as a talent, as an ability to do something, and then my spiritual gifts, which is the Spirit of God and everything that abides in God, putting it together, it becomes a bomb.
Amen.
The same thing, we could talk about painting. You know, some people are very good at painting, and they'll paint a picture, they'll paint something beautiful. But when they use their gift that they developed after so many years, and then they use the presence of God, the glory of God, the essence of God, which is, we've been talking about the Spirit of God in you, then what you're developing, that painting, now it doesn't just become just a regular painting, but it becomes a prophecy for some people. And that's why they call it a prophetic painting. That you, God is speaking to you through a picture. Amen?
Amen.
The same thing happens with a lot of things. Music, dancing. There's so many things. If you just go and list and look at and abilities that probably you are good at. Maybe you're good at business. Maybe you're good at cooking, right? You're good at a lot of stuff. Carlos is good with cameras and computers, and he uses that not just for because he likes it. He does it because he wants to use the Spirit of God in him. He wants the Spirit of God to use him so he can transmit the message, transmit the glory of God. So we come and we get our gifts, what we're good at, and then we use the gift of God, the gift of the Spirit of God, right? And we combine it together and it becomes a powerful thing. So some of us don't understand that. Some of us say, well, I'm good at music. Have you seen musicians that just play music, but there's no spirit?
Yeah.
That's the reason. Some of us, we're just playing music, we're doing things, and that's it. But then there's no connection. Why? Because maybe that person is not connected. Maybe that person is just doing it for a show. Like, I could tell you my life completely. I could tell you many years ago, that's all I wanted to do. Just play music, 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 and that's it. And people will say, well, you're so talented. Yes, but when it comes to my personal life, it was all up and down. But that's how you notice a difference of worshipers and musicians. The same thing you see in pastors the same way. There's pastors that are involved in the Spirit of God, and there's other pastors that are just, and that's because everybody's totally different. And we're not here to bash anybody else. We're not here to say nothing negative. We're just telling you there's difference. Then whatever the Spirit of God moves in that person, that's how the person is going to be. Do you guys understand what I'm trying to say now?
Yeah.
Now, I want us to read a verse in Acts, in the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse 23. So, 38, oh my gosh. So, Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Acts chapter 2, verse 38. And I want you guys to write this down. I want you guys to meditate on this word. I'm going to give you about 2-3 verses that is very important, and I want you guys to meditate on this. Acts 2:38. And Peter answered to them, and it says, you must all be changed by God, by your attitude, by your thinking, and by your actions. You must be baptized by the Spirit of God, by the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, so that your sins will be forgiven. When you do this, you will receive the Spirit of God as a gift. I want us to understand this part. He says, if we give our hearts to God, if we change our minds, we change our ways, we change our actions, we're baptized by God, by the Spirit, by Jesus Christ, our sins are going to be forgiven, correct?
Yes.
Our sins are forgiven. So we become new Christians now.
Amen.
We're baptized. We gave our life to God. Maybe you're not baptized right now, but it's okay. But you gave your life to God, and we're already in the process of you getting baptized. Okay, cool. But the most important thing is that you gave your life to God. Your mind is different. Your mind has changed. Your action has changed. Your attitude has changed. So now the Spirit of God abides in you. So it says here, so you will receive, listen to this, you will receive the Holy Spirit as a gift. So already right there, the Spirit of God is already a gift. Not just the fruit of the Spirit and not just the gift of the Spirit, but the Spirit of God that you already have given your life to God, now that becomes a gift. Amen?
Amen.
We understand that? The Spirit of God is a gift.
Amen.
Is a gift and is given by God Himself. And I want us to read another verse, and I want you guys to write this down, this stuff down in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4 to 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4 to 6. So check this out. The Bible says, there's different kind of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes to them or to everyone. There's different kind of service, but it's the same Lord. We're serving the same Lord, okay? There's different kinds of workings or different kind of works, but all of them is in Him, and it's all, we all do this for God. Amen. So I want to break this down, because this is something different. This is a lot of people think that because you have a gift and I have a gift and maybe we're almost similar, that means that we have to kind of compete. It's not like that. It's saying here, we all have different type of gifts and are all distributed by the presence of God, by the Spirit of God. You have a different gift than I do, but doesn't mean, just because we have a different gift, doesn't mean that we have to compete, because it's given by God.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
The same thing is, we have different type of gifts, but we do the same service. We're still serving the same Lord.
Amen.
The same thing is saying here, that we have different gifts, but the same, the Lord, the God that lives in us, is the one that is working through us so we can do the work for Him. So there's no way to compete. It's impossible, and it shouldn't be a church or people of God, Christians, that say, oh, you know, we're a church here, we're a church there, and we're competing. It's not about competing. It's about working together for the same or for the purpose for God. Amen?
Amen.
Do you guys understand that? So if we understand this, if we have myself, I have gifts, right? And if you have gifts, then why are we competing? Why are we fighting? Why are we fighting for positions? Why are we fighting for, I want this position, I want to be a worship leader, I want to be a pastor, everybody has different type of gifts. Everybody has different type of ways of working in the presence of God, in the ministry. But we shouldn't be competing over this. And this is what God is trying to say. There's a lot of people that want to compete, but yet at the same time, they don't understand that the most important gift that is given to you is the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So if the Spirit of God abides in you, abides to my sister here, isn't it the same here in me?
Of course, amen.
It's the same. The same blood that was shed upon in the cross almost 2,000 years ago is the same blood that comes in me, and it's the same blood that is going through her.
Amen.
The God that died, the Jesus that died in the cross, He died for me and died for her. He didn't just die for me. He died for all of us. So why are we competing? Why are we fighting? Why are we nagging? You know, so these are the things that God is trying to say to us. We're trying to understand now, what are the gifts of the Spirit? Does anybody know what are the gifts of the Spirit? These are 9 gifts of the Spirit, and I want to share it with you guys, because at the same time as I was preparing this message, I just learn a few other things, and within a few weeks, we're gonna dissect each and every one of them, because some of them are very, like, it almost sounds similar, but it's not. They're totally different. So if you go and read 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and you read the whole chapter, you'll see and understand what are the gifts of the Spirit, and which ones are the gifts of the Spirit. So the first gift of the Spirit, it says, word of wisdom. Write this down, word of wisdom. That's the first gift of the Spirit. The second one is word of knowledge. Word of wisdom and word of knowledge is two different things. Then it says, another gift that the Spirit gives is a gift of faith. Now, we understand that the fruit of the Spirit, one of the fruit of the Spirit is faith, but the gift of the Spirit is also faith. People tend to have that gift of having faith. Have you met someone that has so much faith? It's because they're gifted. There's other people that, man, I need to develop the fruit of faith. But there's other people that have that gift of saying, you know what, I have it. I have faith. And so you have that difference of you have the gift, and you have the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is faith, and the gift of Spirit is faith as well. So that's number three. Number four, gift of healing. Gift of healing. Some of us like that. I know Carlos likes gift of healing. He wants to pray and heal the sick. Now, number five, works of miracles. People that pray and miracles happen. And I'm talking about miracles, not about miracles of healing, but I'm talking miracles of maybe somebody's needing a job. Maybe somebody needs a paper for their status here in Canada. Maybe somebody is looking for marriage. Hello. Maybe somebody's looking for, you know, maybe their son or their daughter is having a really hard time. Maybe I know this because it happens. Families that their kids are in jail for problems and difficulties. So they need God to do a miracle in their life. I met families that are breaking up, and they're going into like a breakup and divorce and stuff. And we need to pray for miracles to happen in that family. So there's a gift of miracles. There's people that pray, and there's that gift of miracles. So number six, a gift of prophecy. Everybody knows this one. Gift of prophecy. Then you have discernment of spirits. Does anybody know what's the discernment of spirits?
Yes.
Discernment of spirits. So when you walk into a place, and automatically you understand that where you are right now, there's a spirit or there's something that is not working in you. There's something that is your spirit, you're filled with the Spirit of God. You walk in a place and you understand, hey, there's a clash. There's something that is negative, something that is not good. People call it in the world, people call this a negative vibe. Oh, I feel that person, there's a negative vibe in this person, or I feel that there's this negative thing in that person. But in the Christian world, and what we're talking about, this is not just a vibe or I feel something weird in that person. No, that person has a spirit. Just how it is. And we need to work on that. So sometimes, even my wife, I remember a few years ago that we were at a restaurant, and we were having dinner, and we were with a bunch of friends and family there. And then my wife, I saw her face, and she's just like looking weird. She's like, you know, I'm feeling weird. There's something wrong here. I don't know why. I feel like a heaviness in my heart. I don't know. And then I don't know where, you know, I just told her, oh, it's probably nothing. But she's like, no, I feel like something really bad, something really evil. And she glanced to one side, and in the back of the restaurant, there's a lady, right, with long hair, and her nails were like flipping long, and you could see that she was like speaking, and she was saying these words, and she was like saying some, I don't know, messed up things. So out of nowhere, my wife was like, no, this is a demon. This woman is possessed. This woman is, she's how do you call that, a witch or something. And she was probably praying or doing something. And in that moment, my wife was praying. And I remember clearly, because my wife was like the way she was looking at us, she's like, no, we gotta pray, and she started praying, and then automatically there was a breakthrough. The woman got up and left. Out of nowhere, she left her place, she left everything, and she just walked and left. So you know that there's a conflict. So there's people that have that gift of discernment of spirit. And that's number seven. Number eight, there's a gift of speaking in tongues, different tongues. That's a gift. And there's number nine, the last one, the interpretation of tongues. And there's people that have this gift. These are gifts that the Spirit of God gives to you so you can develop them. Now, some of us probably don't have none of these, and some of them probably you have one or two or three or four or whatever. Some of us probably don't have it, but doesn't mean that you can't have them. You can have these. You just have to ask them. Ask the Spirit of God to give you them. And the only way God can give you this is that you change your attitude, your mind, and your life. And I was telling this to my wife. You know the problem with us Christians is that we don't change our mind, we don't change our mouth, and we don't change our attitude. If we know how to change our mind, our hearts, because they work together. If we can change this part of our bodies, and we can change our mouth, our attitudes towards things, man, I'm telling you, we can be successful. Amen. The problem that we have as Christians is that we want to be base. We want God to just use us in this base area. This is our level. Now, let me ask you a question before I go into this same topic, but just in another twist. Do you think God can use you even though you're in sin?
Yes. Totally.
So some of us probably say no and yes, and I want to change. Not that I want to change it. It's just I want to see it in a Bible perspective. And a lot of people say, well, God cannot use you if you're sin. Well, God cannot use you if you're this and if you're that. Well, my wife said the other day, if God can use a donkey,
yes,
he has done, and though you can see it in the Bible, then God can actually use you.
Yes.
Now, my question is this. This is my question. If God can use you, even though you're in sin, there's a certain of level of how God can use you. God can use you, but then there's going to be a level, there's going to be a time where God cannot put his hand anymore. He could say, well, Alan, I'm going to use you for this and for that, but that's your level. That's the only way I can't go more. Not because I'm God, not because I'm a powerful God. This is what God's saying. I'm a powerful God. I can do anything. I'm the creator of heaven and earth. The problem is that your attitude, your ways, your action is not good. So I can't work more on that. I can use you in this, I can use you in that, and in these little areas, but I can't go more than that. Because you need to change. If you want me to use you in this way, if you want to prophesy, if you want a word of wisdom, word of knowledge, if you want to you want to get to that level, you need to change. There's areas that you need to change, and the only way you can change, it's by you seeking the presence of God and you having that relationship with God, you having that intimacy with God. That's something that we've been preaching and talking about here a lot. And we say this because we want to get to this level where God is showing us and taking us. We don't want to be just in a base area. We don't want it just to be in that same level. I don't know about you. I want to go deeper in God's presence.
Amen, amen.
This is my desire. This is the desires of God for us. Let me tell you something I was sharing with my wife. I was saying, I think I was talking to her about it. Or I think I was talking to someone else. Anyways, I was telling her, look, when I was in high school, you know, I was really bad in high school. Like, if I talk to you a little bit of my testimony, man, one day I will talk to you guys more about it. But I was really bad in high school. I didn't graduate high school until I was 21. I was supposed to graduate when I was 18. So you can imagine that right there. Anyways, my thoughts, my mentality of passing high school was, as long as I get a 50, I'm good. That was my thought. And I told her, I was telling this person, I was like, as long as I get a 50, a 52, a 53, a 54, hey, I'm good. As long as I get that, then I pass. And that some Christians, they think this. This is our attitude. Well, you know, as long as I'm saved, I'm good. As long as I come to church, I'm good. As long as I give my tithes, my 10%, as long as I do this, then I'm good. I don't need to give more to God. I don't need to be a leader. I don't need to do anything else. I just got to come, do what I got to do, and that's it. Don't get me involved. I don't want to be a leader. I don't want to do all these 9 fruit of the Spirit, 9 gifts of the Spirit. I don't need this. I don't need ministry. I just want to sit down, go to church, be a good Christian, listen, and that's it. So we want to be comfortable with that same level. So don't look at the person beside you and say, hey, that's you. Don't do that. Don't do that. Trust me. You guys are looking at each other now. Okay. Now you guys are looking at each other. So I want you guys to focus and say, is this going through my life? Am I doing the same thing? You know, am I doing something for God? Am I just walking in that base? Am I just in that level? Am I just hoping for that? So back in the day, I was just, hey, as long as I get a 50, I'm good. As long as I pass, because my mom was like, you got to go to school. You got to pass. You got to have an education. And my counselor back in the day, she's like, hey, to pass, you got to get a 50. So I'm like, listen, I'm not going to do my homework. I'm just going to go to school, be good, do a little bit of homework, and pass. And that's it. I'm good. With a 50, I'm good. But I didn't want to strive for more. I didn't want to get an 80. I didn't want to get a 90. After God, of course, God came and transformed me, and I was able to graduate. And I was able to graduate with 3 honors. Well, that's pretty good, right? Woo! Well, God had to really change my life. And now we come to church and we say, okay, well, are we ready to be into a different level? I was telling my wife, I think it was yesterday or this week. I'm like, someone asked me this question, and I want to answer it to you. Do you want, how much do you want to get paid? That's what this pastor was telling, this man of God asked me, how much do you want to get paid? And I looked at him, I'm like, huh, that's a good question. I want to get paid $20 an hour. And he looks at me, he's like, that's it? And I didn't know if it was a good thing or a bad thing. I'm like, okay, if it's a bad thing, then am I asking for too much? Or maybe it's too little. And he's like, Alan, that's it? So I'm like, okay, fine. I want to get paid $60 an hour. And he looks at me. And he answers the same question. He goes, that's it? I'm like, well, $60 an hour is good, right?
Yeah.
It's good. I'll take it anytime, yeah. So then he asked that question again. He goes, that's how much you want to get paid? And I'm like, okay, fine. I want to get paid $100 an hour. That's good. You work 8 hours, that's $800 a day. You times it, you know, weekly, you times it monthly. Oh my God, that's a lot of money.
But a lot of quick taxes.
So I'm thinking, okay, that's good. Yeah, you pay a lot of taxes after that. But I'm thinking, okay, that's good. He looks at me again and he goes, that's it? And the reason why he's saying this to me is not because I'm being egoistic or I want more. No, it's just he's saying, if God has the ability to give you something, why are you giving him a limit? If God is God, if God is powerful, if God is everything, if God is the creator of heaven and earth, if he's the owner of diamonds and gold, if he's the owner of the universe, if he's God, which we do worship him and honor him, then why do we give him limits? We don't just give him limits in our own pay or our own money, but we give him limits even in our own personal life. God wants to work in us, and he's like, come on. I want to go to your house. But we're like, okay, God, enter into my house. But you're just here as a visitor, okay? So you don't come and live here in my house. You just come and visit. That's it. Sit in the chair. I'll serve you. So you come, you're serving God, but God doesn't want you to be. God wants to serve you. He wants to help you. He wants to change you. But you just want God to come into your heart. You come into your heart. He comes into your heart. And he comes into your house, which is your heart. He comes in and he wants to stay. He wants to live there, but you don't allow him because you just want him to visit. You just want him to visit. That's all you want to do. And we have that problem because, see, God, when he comes into your heart, when he comes into your life, right? When the Father comes into your heart and he says, okay, I want to abide in you. I want to live in you. I want to live in your heart. He's going to change areas in your life. So picture him coming into your heart and he goes into your sofa and he says, listen, this is a nice sofa. You've been living in this sofa. This sofa has been here for 30 years. We've got to change it up. And you're like, no, I don't want to change this sofa. This sofa is good how it is. And God is like, wait, listen, there's roaches in this sofa. You know, there's mold in this sofa. We've got to change this sofa. And you're having this battle. And God is like, hey, you've got to change it. You want me to live in your house? We got to change this. So God comes and gives you a new sofa. And then slowly he starts changing. Maybe you have a picture in the wall he has to change. Maybe there's a carpet that needs to be changed. God is going to start changing areas in your life. But if you have him only as a visitor, God, come into my heart only on Sundays, only on Fridays, only when I need you. But I don't need you. That's it. I just need you for those moments. Then we cannot expect the fruit of the Spirit. We can't expect the gift of the Spirit being developed in our hearts because of our thoughts. You guys understand what I'm trying to say?
Yes, amen.
We have that tendency. So God can work with us. If you're in sin, God will still work in you. If there's areas in your life that needs to be changed, fine. He knows that. He'll work with that. But if you don't change, if you don't give your life and say, God, I give my life away so you can use me. I give you all my heart so you can do whatever you want. If our attitude is not like that, then we cannot be the victorious Christians that we need to be or that we should be. We want to be victorious? Then why are we in the same level? Spiritually speaking. Why are we still stuck in the same thing? How come there's no rivers of water? How come there's no life in us anymore? Because we're stuck in the same thing. We're base. That's all. That's where God wants us there. That's it. I mean, that's what you think. We want God to use us, but we just want to be there in that same level. I don't want more. I don't want less. I just want there. Those $20 an hour, I'm good with that. You guys understand what I'm trying to say?
Amen.
I want to give an illustration. I want Carlos to come up to the front. My buddy Carlos. Carlos, today's your lucky day.
Amen.
Maybe somebody could help him with a camera. I did this illustration a few years ago, and I think it's, I wanted to share it with you guys. I don't know if maybe some of you guys already had it or saw it, but I want to give this illustration. Carlos is a man of God.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
But for a few minutes, Carlos, not just a man of God, but he's going through stuff. You know, he's going through situations, right? And he's having a lot of problems in his heart. There's a lot of situations he's going through, maybe spiritually, physically, mentally, whatever. So this is a test, right? But I want Carlos, as he is standing here, I want Carlos to work, right? So I want you to work out, okay? So I want you to do this squat, just go like that, up and down, slowly, okay? Yeah, keep on going, up and down, up and down. Yeah, keep on going.
Oh, faster or slowly?
No, slowly, slowly, because you're gonna be here for a while. More down. Yeah, there, that's good. So you keep on doing that. Carlos is going to start breaking a sweat. So Carlos, the man of God, working out. He's working out. God is using him. He's working out his legs, his arms, right? He's breaking a sweat. Look at him. He's breaking a sweat. Right? So God is using him right now at this moment. God is using him, right? Keep on going. So then the enemy comes and says, you know what, Carlos, I'm gonna bring some problems in your life. So he starts putting some doubts in his life. So he comes and puts a small little chain of doubt. And he's still working out, right? He's still working. He's still working for God, but he has something chain in his heart, a chain in his life. Maybe, drugs or, pornography. It could be jealousy. It could be not loving his wife or not loving his friends or, a situation is his heart. So slowly, God, the enemy comes and puts another chain, maybe a chain of anger, right? Can he still work? Yeah, he's still doing his stuff. He's still working out. He's still giving to God what he's doing. But at the same time, now it's becoming a little heavy, right? Sooner or later, the enemy comes and says, oh, well, you're not praying enough. So, he comes and because you don't have a relationship with God. So he comes in and says, I want to put another chain. And that chain, maybe it could be, a chain of
gambling.
Yeah, it could be gambling. What else? You guys give me another one. The enemy comes and gives them another one. What do you guys say?
Resentful.
Okay, resentful. Let's keep on going, Carlitos. I know it's hurting. I know it's hurting. So, the enemy comes and puts another one. And he says, hey.
Shoot, this is heavy.
Yeah, it's hurting, right, Carlos? You can feel it in your legs. Which one is this one? What do you guys say?
Negativity.
Okay, let's put negativity. So the enemy comes. Is he still working? Yeah, he's still working. You notice that his arms are going a little bit more down. He's trying. He's trying, giving it better. Well, here comes another chain. Enemy comes and says, hey. And these are baggage the enemy puts in your life all the time. Even Christians. Even pastors. Even leaders. Get to me?
I know it's hurting. Faithful.
So the enemy comes and says, let's put some more, right? Let's get some more. I know it's heavy.
Oh,
I know it's hurting. So he's putting more stuff in his heart. Maybe he got abused. Maybe he got hate.
Unfaithful.
Yeah. Keep on going. I didn't stop. So the enemy comes and puts more stuff. Maybe suicide, right?
Fear, yeah.
Maybe they feel like I wanna suicide.
Yeah.
Look, he's hurting. Now he's stopping a little bit. He's still working, but now it's heavy. God cannot use somebody that has so much baggage. So the enemy comes and puts something more heavier.
Wow.
So now Carlos is like, oh my God, I don't know if I can do this. Look how heavy it is. Carlos, what do you think?
It is heavy.
It's okay. So Carlos, continue doing this. And this is where the enemy wants him. Because the more he does it, the more tired he's going to be, and the more that he's going to fall. And that's where he wants you to be. Enemy wants you to be in that situation. Right? I didn't tell you to stop. So what happens is that in a moment, after he does this, he stumbles and falls. Pretend you fall, or pretend you're not on the floor.
On the floor.
So now, no, pretend you're down on the floor, so pull down the floor. So now he's down the floor. Tírate en el piso. Now he's down the floor. And that's where the enemy wants him. Now he can't get up because he's full of chains. It's hard for him. After years and years of baggage and stuff in their heart. And instead of having the fruit of the Spirit, instead of having joy, peace, love, kindness, faithfulness, self-control, instead of having the gifts of the Spirit, now he has all these baggage in his heart. And it's becoming heavy. So instead of us Christians looking and helping him out, we come and we even putting more burdens. So these type of people leave the church and say, I don't want to be at church anymore. Because at church, they criticize me. They talk bad about me. They say so many things about me. And I don't want to be in this situation anymore. So the Spirit of God comes in still working on Carlos and says, Carlos, listen, it's not about the people, but it's about me. It's about Jesus.
Amen.
It's about the Spirit of God in me. And even though he's tired, even though his he's anguished, even though maybe he's going through so much. Jesus comes and says, Carlos, I'm going to pick you up. I'm going to raise you up. Even though you are in a situation, even though you're in so much debt, even though you're much so much hurt, I will still bless you.
Amen.
And while you are having that communication, that worship, that even when you start working more and more and more in the presence of God, having that devotion, having that intimacy that we've been talking a lot, your baggage will be out.
Removed.
It will be removed.
You're free.
And now he can work freely. Now he can work, he can move, now he can continue working. Continue working. Freely. Okay. Thank you. Give him an applause. Thank you, Carmen. It's heavy. But we go through so much stuff like that. If we don't have the Spirit of God in our hearts, this is how we're going to become. And it's not just we. I mean the church. And I'm not talking about just Shekinah Grace 24/7. I'm talking globally. All the church. All the Christians. Everybody that says they love Jesus. This is how we're going to go if we don't really devote ourselves. We talk about this all the time, but we want you to understand this. This is vital. This is important. If we don't have the presence of God in our hearts, then we shouldn't have church. And I don't care if we have 4 or 5 or 20 people or 20,000 people. It's still the same. If we love God, man, I prefer having, and I'm going to say this again, I'll say it again every time. I prefer having 20 people. And I know those 20 people will go to heaven than having 20,000 people and only 20 will go to heaven and 20,000 and the rest of the thousands of people will go to hell. That's reality, church.
Yes.
We our desires as pastors is for you to be closer to God. Not because of our benefit, it's because it brings benefit for you. Why? Because the closer you are with God, the better and victorious that you become for him. We're not just about those, I just want to get to that level and I'm good. If I get there, then I'm a good Christian. And that's wrong. I want to get wherever God wants me to go.
Amen.
I want to talk whatever he says. I want to hear what he's saying. I want to do what God is doing. That's my desire. If God's desire for this church to be 20,000, then 20,000 it is.
Amen.
If God's desire is for us to be here and continue pressing on, then let's press on.
Amen.
If God's desire is for us to work hard, let's work hard. Let's do this. Let's don't do this because, you know, for people to see us or how great our ministry or how big we are. No, let's do this because we love God and we love the people. I want to show you a video. Angie, can you kill the lights in the back? There's this video that really struck me and I want you guys to see this video and in the beginning, hopefully you guys understand that there's a woman with Jesus. You can see Jesus and everything that he does, she does it. Everything she does, right? And then you'll see in the video what happens in her life. I want you guys to just take a look at this.
Where I found
into my soul. You are my purpose. You're everything. It's how can I stand here with you and not be moved by it? Would you tell
so much, and the enemy is just attacking, but as long as we're continue fighting, as long as we continue pressing on, Jesus will always be there to protect us and to help us.
Amen.
And that's where we want you to be, in that level, where no matter what situation you're going through, as long as you have Jesus in your heart, He will always make a way. He will always make a way. It's important that you guys, that we all have that devotion of seeking the presence of God. It's important that we do this so we can be successful, so we can be victorious. Mm-hmm. Just ask that you stand in the presence of God.